good to be alive in this land of ours. Good to drive in this land of ours.
Hello, Canada and hockey fans in the United States. Hi, everybody. Steve Paikin here. Happy to be with you for another edition of Hockey Time Machine. And I think we got a really good one, particularly for people of a certain generation and who may be fans of a certain particular hockey team. Maybe one of the most storied franchises in the history of hockey anywhere in the world. We're going to talk this week about a book called Revival, The Chaotic, Colourful Journey of the 1977-78 Toronto Maple Leafs. And one of the authors is Gord Stellick, who's a former general manager of the Toronto Maple Leafs, and he joins us now from Toronto. And Gord, really happy to have you on the Hockey Time Machine again. How are you doing tonight?
I'm doing outstanding. Always great to talk to you and great to talk hockey.
Excellent. It's interesting. One of the first things you say in the book is that despite the fact that you are writing about one of the most beloved hockey teams of all time, and this is, you know, this is the Darryl Sittler Maple Leafs, Lanny McDonald, Börje, Salming, Mike Palmateer, that's this group, not much has actually been written about this era. Why not?
You know, great question. You know, it's funny. I you know, Damien and I did a book on the 67 Leaf team. And of course, you can write about them because they won four Stanley Cups in 7 years. And that's the last time they won a Stanley Cup. And I've enjoyed Ed Willis did a book on the World Hockey Association. When you look like an ESPN 30 and 30, Al Davis and Pete Rozelle. And even the Harold Ballard documentary that I was involved in, you know, with, you know, a bunch of other, you know, a bunch of people like Michael Geddes and that and Jason and all that. It was really, you know, kind of a great story. So, you know, great stories stand the test of time. And I don't know why that people don't do that, don't embrace that, because, OK, the Leafs didn't win. It's like the Buffalo Bills was a great story when they did their 30 for 30 about the four falls of Buffalo getting to the Super Bowl four times. So I really liked, you know, it hasn't been all bad times for the Toronto Maple Leafs since 1967. And there was a real shining moment in the 70s.
Well, we should remind people, this was a team that, again, we don't use this term in the NHL, but it's a fact. They got to the Final Four 2 years in a row, and they looked like they were just sort of one step away from competing for the Stanley Cup. Tell us what, in your view, made that team, again, for people of our generation, so magical to follow.
Yeah, you know, it's, and where I find a comparable right now, Steve, is that what people can look at is the Toronto Maple Leafs of homegrown Austin Matthews, Mitch Marner, Morgan Rielly, William Nylander. And really, there hasn't been, you know, Pat Quinn's teams had Gary Roberts and Matt Sundin and Curtis Joseph. They weren't homegrown. Pat Burns' team, Doug Gilmore, Dave Andrechuk, you know, those kind of players, you know, they Bob Rouse, they weren't homegrown. And the comparable is this was a team put together by the most underrated general manager in NHL history. I'm a little biased, Jim Gregory, about all those guys, Darryl Sittler, Lanny McDonald, Tiger Williams, Börje Salming, Ian Turnbull, Mike Palmateer. They were all drafted or signed as free agents by the Leafs. And they came together and had these couple of great moments that this team has not yet had. And then, unfortunately, it was kind of left unfulfilled. But that was the greatness about it, about these big personalities there from day one.
Well, we can't talk about this period of Toronto Maple Leaf history without talking about the guy who owned the team, Harold Ballard. You pointed out, you participated in a documentary about him that I guess Jason Priestley produced not too long ago. Ballard and Smythe, Stafford Smythe, one of the co-owners, they both went to jail at this point. Fraud, for defrauding Maple Leaf Garden shareholders. Smythe ends up dying. Why was Harold Ballard not forced out at the time when he was in jail? That was, it seems to me that could have been the moment when he might have been forced out of ownership of the team, but it didn't happen. Why not?
Well, the documentary you talk about, and it's funny, I learned a lot of stuff from Jason Priestley, Michael Geddes, the documentary on Ballard. And apparently, when they were voted out of the board of directors of Maple Leaf Gardens Limited, and that 1 year, and John Bassett took over, he at that point could have forced them to relinquish their shares. And that's his big regret. He didn't. So apparently that was the opportunity to do it in kind of a corporate type way within the rules. Going to jail, I mean, I don't know. I have no experience going to jail, but I guess a lot of people, when they go to jail, you still have the right to come back and run whatever companies you owned when you went in. So apparently the miss, if they were going to do that, was a few years before at the board level.
Now, you've got a couple of stories in this book that I want to fact check with you here, because it's hard for me to imagine that a guy who owns an NHL team and who was paying some of his players pretty decent money, he loved Börje Salming, he was taking him to the Cayman Islands on vacation. Is it really true the Leafs would charter a plane to leave at 7:35 p.m. instead of 7:30 p.m. because that would save Harold Ballard $15 a day in per diems for his players?
Correct. And I bet you, Steve, probably not the only team. I mean, they were run like mom and pop organizations back then. You think about 1983, nobody wanted to buy the St. Louis Blues for $6 million. It languished, and then Harry Ernest got them for $6 million. So, yes, you think about now the sports science nowadays, having your team best prepared, you know, to play the next day. You're leaving at 7:35. You know, you get in about 9 o'clock. You get to the hotel about 10. You go over for a meal. It's on your dime. You're not in bed. You got a morning skate. Yes. The almighty dollar was a number one concern above anything else.
Let's do another story. Apparently, Harold Ballard dressed up one year as Santa Claus for the Garden's Christmas party, and he gave all the Toronto Maple Leaf players boom boxes and then deducted the cost of those boom boxes from their salaries. True or false?
False. What he was very generous at Christmas. I think what we're finding more and more nowadays, because later on it became trips for two anywhere in North America, including Hawaii. We had a deal with American Airlines. What they did, Steve, people don't like it. Back then was the good old Contra days. That was the start of getting a T4 slip or getting a taxable gift, okay? So that's what happened back then. He did that, but people's memories play tricks on them.
Okay, gotcha. Now, let's also put this into context in as much as Harold Ballard is trying, I guess, to build himself a Stanley Cup contender around the same time as the World Hockey Association is poaching some of the best players from the NHL. What impact did that have on his ability to create a Stanley Cup contender?
Huge. And Steve, and by the way, the thing you said before, that was a player's recollection when you're talking about the booth. So just, to be clear, people have different recollections, but so we of course printed what they said, direct quotes. So, okay, back then, Steve, he's older than we are now, okay, at that particular point. You and I just got a chance at the Toronto Maple Leafs. We never thought we got the Toronto Maple Leafs. We're kicking ass. So I don't care. I'm going to get page one all the time. I'm that kind of personality. I own the Leafs, okay? I'm overextended. I got a big loan from the TD Bank. So, okay, I'm watching my pennies. A bunch of guys go to the World Hockey Association, like Bernie Perrault and Jim Harrison in particular, who would have been huge guys to help the team. But I'm just trying to remain financially solvent, which was a struggle in the 70s. But Jim Gregory is going about putting that team together to try to win a Stanley Cup and doing a really good job. I mean, Harold is enjoying that part of it. He's expecting and wanting the team to win. But because he's on the cheap and is stretched financially, it's kind of counterproductive, you know? It's kind of a check and a balance in opposite directions.
The Toronto entry into the World Hockey Association was called the Toros. How much of a threat were they to Ballard's operation?
No, they just kind of lined his coffers. So the World Hockey Association, part of why the Leafs did not pay to retain players was Ballard had a lot of respect for the president, Clarence Campbell. Clarence Campbell said the WHA won't last. Don't give in and pay the players. I think also it suited Ballard's pocketbook and the way he wanted to go about things. So some teams like the New York Rangers and the Chicago Blackhawks, especially when they lost Bobby Hull, then re-upped and kept their players. And Toronto was probably an example of maybe the worst of the original six teams that, you know, let them all fly there. I don't think there ever was a moment that the World Hockey Association was going to supplant the NHL. It took away some prime expansion locations for them at that particular time. And it certainly made them pay a lot more in salaries. And they didn't necessarily raise revenues or more revenues commensurate with that.
Let me circle back to Bernie Perrault, because, of course, he'd go on to be, I guess, the best goalie in the NHL in the middle 1970s and help Philadelphia win two Stanley Cups. How did he end up getting away from the Leafs, and why couldn't they figure that out? Because presumably that Leaf team would have done a whole lot better if they'd been able to keep him.
Yeah, and the story is true. If you imagine that the Leafs still don't have a goaltender the ilk of, say, Bernie Perrault, but whoever your number was, say Curtis Joseph in his day, and all of a sudden on an off day on a Sunday, he flies down to Miami to announce he's going to join the rival new league the next year, then flies back home and is ready the next day to practice as a Toronto Maple Leaf. But in Bernie Perrault's case, Jim Gregory was right. His wife did not want to stay in Toronto, didn't like it there. She was a Philadelphia area person. So when Bernie went to the World Hockey Association, it wasn't working out. And Jim Gregory was absolutely the resolve. He said, okay, he's going to want to play. If he's going to play in the NHL, we have his rights and he's going to have to play here. Too bad. Okay, that's just the way it's going to have to go. Lou Lamoriello did that with Scott Stevens in New Jersey initially when he went from St. Louis. And of course, he ended up enjoying it there. So that's what Jim was doing. Now, Harold was getting antsy. Okay, we don't have a goaltender and could get an asset. And at a board of governors meeting, apparently, Gil Stein, who later became the commissioner of the NHL or president of the NHL, he was the Flyers' legal counsel. And he kind of cornered Ballard and said, hey, you know what? You know, we'll take him. He wants to play here. You're not going to get anything. He doesn't want to play anywhere else. So he forced Jim Gregory to make that trade. They got Doug Favell and a first-round pick, but they lost Bernie Perrault. And Jim, again, being a guy with a lot of it, being a real good visionary, that was a big miss. Fortunately, by the time we talk about the team in revival, it's about a three-year window where Mike Palmateer happened to be a phenomenal NHL goaltender.
We're going to come back to Palmateer, but I want to just let me follow up on, I guess, what the biggest acquisitions the Leafs made at this period of time in the middle 70s, early to middle 70s. And that was, for all the mistakes that Ballard was making, at least, I guess, he and or his team was smart enough to get over to Sweden and find Börje, Salming, and Inge Hammarström. So they get good marks for that, I presume.
Yeah.
But having said that, did you have any conversations with Harold about the time that he said Inge Hammarström could go into the corner with six eggs in his pocket and none of them would get broken? And if so, how did that conversation go?
Well, it's funny because, he always talked about it later, and he got a kick out of it. He thought it was funny. We all think that King Clancy said it privately because King had the funny lines, and then Harold just kind of used it. And so the strange part, and again, I'm not shilling the book, but it's talked about, Inge Hammarström ends up renting space at Maple Leaf Gardens for a skate sharpening machine. And he ends up being a scout for the Philadelphia Flyers, the very Broad Street Bullies that kind of tried to run him out of the league and kind of brought up that line. So it was one that, in all honesty, Harold Ballard never regretted anything. Okay. He had no regrets. He had fewer than Frank Sinatra. Frank had a few, apparently. Harold had none. But I think if there's a thing that he kept saying, who cares? Who cares what they say? Whatever. It should, like, he didn't care what people said about him as long as they spelled his name right and he got the headline. So he never quite understood that these kind of barbs, he thought we should all be able to take it, was basically.
But Inge Hammarström was genuinely emotionally affected by that comment, was he not?
Yeah. You think about it. I mean, nowadays in any sport, an owner coming out and saying that, because it wasn't like a guy's not playing well. Like Steve Paikin hasn't been playing well. Well, he's got one goal in 12 games. He's not playing well. It's just questioning your whole ability to even be on the ice because you're living in such fear. So, and the thing was, he really didn't mean it to that degree. It just was a great line, and he loved great lines.
All right, let's follow up on Jim Gregory here, because you point out he was a very underrated general manager. You've got a Toronto roster at this point that includes, we've talked about Sittler, McDonald, Turnbull, Salming, Tiger Williams, but there's also George Ferguson and Pat Buttet and Rick Kehoe, who are also, pretty good parts to a puzzle. In your judgment, how far away was this team, that team in particular, from competing for a Stanley Cup?
Well, in talking to guys like Darryl Sittler and others as well, and in my opinion, because the Montreal Canadiens were a great team. Okay. So first, the Stanley Cup. So the elite teams were Montreal, Boston, Philadelphia back then in the mid to late 70s. And Montreal, cut away and was the premier team that won four Stanley Cups in a row. There's no question they never got that number two center, whether it was George Ferguson, whether it was Walt McKechnie, whether it was trading for Paul Gardner, they never got that. They needed that, and they needed one more defenseman. Palmateer was giving them excellent goaltending. They had everything else, but I think at a minimum they needed that. And then also when they made some of the trades, like, you know, with Roger, you know, they brought in Dave Burrows, and they traded George Ferguson and Randy Carlisle. Okay, they brought in Dave Hutchison, and they made a trade. So Jerry Butler for Inge Hammarström. I mean, Jerry Butler served a certain role, but it could also be argued that in enforcing or playing Roger's style of physical, brutal, almost half goonery style that was prevalent back then, you know, you may have given up a little too much in talent. You also had back-to-back drafts when Don Ashby was a high first-round pick. Jack Valiquette was a high first-round pick. They were both centers. They never really materialized as a, you know, a good core six center as well. So there's no question, even though Punch Imlach came in his second go-round and basically annihilated the team, that there were pieces lacking for them to get to the promised land.
Hmm. All right. The Roger, of course, you referred to as Roger Neilson, and I want to ask you about another leader of that team. And this leader believed in a certain kind of mysticism. And I'll put this on the record, and you know where I'm going here. Darryl Sittler put six of his hockey sticks under a bunch of pyramids and then went out and scored five goals in one game. This is not the six goals in one game. This is another game, five in one game. Does he believe that putting the sticks under the pyramids had something to do with that?
I don't think he believes, but then he's not going to say that because he's not going to disbelieve. And of course, we're talking about the Red Kelly era, which also, what in talking to everyone, you talk about Lanny McDonald just talked about Red and Andrea Kelly took him under their wing and he'd have dinner there. Inge Hammarström said he was the most special person he ever met. So you think about that, you don't think of a coach like John Tortorella like that, you know, being kind of a surrogate dad in that respect, but Red as well. And it was trying something different. Like the Flyers had Kate Smith, whenever she sang God Bless America or they played the recording of it, it was viewed as a good luck charm. And they had a great record doing that. So it was something that Red Kelly thought of. I don't even think he really believed in it, but just the whole pyramid thing, and he'd explain it, and it had a time, and in the playoffs, it caught momentum. Some of the guys had success. I know Guy Kinnear, the trainer, talked about that even years later at the Spectrum, there still was something set around the visiting team's bench, because when they were playing the Flyers in the playoffs under Red Kelly, I guess they got some, they had to get a plug-in for something to plug in the pyramids, right? So they made a special, you know, kind of a form for that to get it done, amendment and that, and it was still there, whatever that outlet was that was put in there that years earlier.
I do want to ask you about the guy who, since I was 10 years old, was my favorite player in the NHL and still is one of the finest men I've ever met in my life, and that's Ron Ellis, who just was passed by Austin Matthews, I guess, about a month ago, as the fourth all-time leading goal scorer on the team. 332 goals for Ron Ellis during his career, which he only ever suited up for the blue and white, never played for anybody else. In your view, what was his role on this team?
Well, it's first of all, we do a chapter on Jim McKenney and Ron Ellis because they're the only two that were part of the organization in 67 and part of this 1978 team. And also, like say if Jenny Kuznetsov nowadays, there was no program available for players like Carey Price did to help deal with their problems. And so first to talk about it, a lot of it deals with Ron Ellis battling with depression and how all that went. And it was kind of a lonely battle and was told to get over it. So this is a real nice chapter that he views this as a chance to come back. Roger really likes him. Jim Gregory really likes him. He missed two entire seasons. A guy like, 29 or 30 or 28? He wasn't that old. So he comes back very, very nervous about it. And it ends up being, it starts slowly, but it ends up, first of all, he provides, you know, a lot of veteran stuff to what's basically a very young team. I mean, Randy Carlisle just mentioned that he was kind of pissed when he wasn't playing around the time of the playoffs when he had been playing. And he talked to Ron, and Ron said, no, you got to park it. You got to park it. Okay, you got to. And then Randy did get in later on in the playoffs. So Ron served that role, but also just a solid two-way player that they needed. So it's a real nice chapter in a guy that who's just, as you say, what a wonderful guy, but is very upfront and continues today, you know, to battle mental illness issues. I don't like using the word courageous. I'll use it for Ron Ellis, how he's battled it throughout that. And it's nice to see that's a year that he looks back with incredibly fond memories. He appreciates how Roger treated him and everyone else giving him the chance.
I agree. I think he's one of the bravest guys in sports, the way he has been so open in talking about his affliction, which was brought on, I presume, in part because he suffered. Remember, of course, he played before helmets.
Yeah.
He suffered numerous concussions, which gave him, you know, brain fog, which made exacerbated his depression. And you have to believe, Gord, that if he'd played today instead of 40 and 50 years ago, that our more progressive attitude to these things would have resulted in him having a quite different career in the NHL. Would you agree?
Totally. Totally. I mean, for starters, you look at, we talked about Inge Hammarström earlier. Well, this era, the last 20 years, Inge would have thrived. Okay. Here he comes over the Broad Street Bullies era. And then to your point about Ron Ellis and a lot of other people out there that just, you know, battled certain things and did not, were not provided the assistance or even not even felt they could go out and seek it on their own. And nowadays, boy, yeah, he gets it. Just a consummate, consummate pro. Ron Ellis was.
Okay, let me circle back to Roger Neilson as well, because, of course, as we look at it 40 years later, Roger Neilson was considered one of the most forward-thinking people associated with the game, right? His nickname was Captain Video. He was into analytics in a way nobody else was at the time. He did a lot of homework, a lot of due diligence. On the other hand, you've referenced the fact that there's a lot of goonery associated with his hockey, and a lot of great players left Toronto and ended up doing better in other places. So in your view, what's the verdict? What's the ultimate verdict on Roger Neilson?
Oh, well, the ultimate verdict is just one of the great guys I've ever met. And, you know, Steve, I look back, and one reason this is a labor of love, in 1978, I was working part-time in the office. And I used to kid when I introduced Jim Gregory once, I set up at a charity thing and just said I was mad at him. And everyone's kind of going, what do you mean? Geez, you really? And I talked about whether it's Jim Gregory, Roger Neilson, King Clancy, Johnny Bauer, Jerry McNamara, Johnny McClellan, like all these people. And I said, I didn't realize the world wasn't like that. I met all these great people that had your back, that championed you. That was it, you know, and the world is a dog-eat-dog world, knife you in the back. And Roger was a big part of that. And, you know, first, it's funny, I'll bring a recent one up because, you know, about a week or two ago, there was that game where the Minnesota Wild, in overtime, pulled the goaltender
yes.
and scored. And not a lot of people realized the rule was if the empty net goal went against them, they wouldn't get a point. And I asked Coley Campbell about this. We had him on our radio show. And he said, well, when we put the rule together in 2005, it was Coley Campbell, Jim Gregory, and a few other people. And the first thing they'd always go was, okay, how would Roger Neilson find a way to beat this rule? And then they figured out he probably would start overtime with the goaltender pulled. And so that would kind of defeat the whole point that they wanted three-on-three hockey. So that's why they put that in. But to get back to you, Captain Video, he was a guy that year on his own, would put together, splice together a videotape and then have a game report for all the guys way ahead of his time. There was a game in St. Louis. If it wasn't on TV, they'd arrange to the local PR people, can you get a community college student to video the game? And Roger, I guess this person was kind of inept, and he's helping her set up the camera and having trouble. And all of a sudden, there's the anthem, and he's got to run down through the seats to get behind the Leaf bench for the start of the game. But he, systems and everything, you know, out of control. He absolutely, whatever your team was, he would make it better all the time. But he never won championships. And that may be, if you're going to be critical, I don't even like using that word, was the system. And Mark Messier said that in New York when he was with him, didn't allow the superstar so much to be the superstar. And, you know, Darryl Sittler remembers Roger very, very fondly. But I know from talking to guys that along the way, he'd get a little pissed sometimes too, because, you know, Roger had, but they respected when it was done. He was so far and away ahead of his time and in coaching and making a team a better team, and a great guy off the ice. Like a funny guy off the ice, a personal guy off the ice, a genuine guy off the ice.
He never married and had no kids. Did you ever talk to him about that in your private moments?
Yeah, you know, it was weird. He would come to training camp because he enjoyed the summer. He was a big kid. He was up in Peterborough. He had his camp. He hung with the young people. They're always playing at his place. He goes, man, it takes me a few days to get back in the adult world. You know, it just was this Shangri-La. And some people were suspicious. Okay. Some people kind of wondered, it's different. He also became incredibly deeply religious, and that really evolved as a part of his life, but he really marched to his own drummer. And his love was embracing life, sports. He may even actually have loved baseball more than hockey. I don't know, but that was just it. And he just had a way about organizing things and making things fun and wanted to be a part of the fun.
Okay, let's talk about what probably was the apex of this Maple Leafs team of the 1970s, and that was in the spring of 1978. The Leafs dispatched the Los Angeles Kings in the first round of the playoffs, and they are facing the New York Islanders in the spring of 78 in the second round of the playoffs. And let's start by having you take us through the matchups. It seemed to me at the time that the Maple Leafs were just vastly overmatched in almost every aspect of the game vis-a-vis the Islanders. What did you think?
Absolutely. Absolutely. The Islanders and, you know, Chico Resch and Brian Trotche, I talked extensively with them. And this is a team that it would be 2 years later would start winning their first of 2-4 Stanley Cups. And the loss to the Leafs in 78 and then being upset by the New York Rangers, being upset by the Leafs in 78, upset by the Rangers in 79 were different building points and helped them grow. And in 78, there's no question. The Islanders were just a force. And I didn't, you know, nobody really picked the Leafs, particularly when they went down 2-0 on the island. But, you know, as they talk about it, they started believing in, like, Roger Neilson. This is where he said, keep in mind, Harold Ballard said these remarks, 6 years earlier about Inge Hammarström, because the Leafs were viewed as a soft team. Teams like the Philadelphia Flyers, St. Louis Blues, and the Boston Bruins, as that era was changing, were dining out on teams like the Toronto Maple Leafs. So the Leafs had started getting physical, and then they got really physical under Roger Neilson. And Chico Resch looks at this series with disdain. He just sees the goaltender for the Islanders. You know, first of all, he said Mike Palmateer played off the charts. Ian Turnbull played off the charts. But he said, it's an era that's gone, and it will never come back, and that's the better. They just hacked, whacked, gooned, speared, did anything it was, whatever it would be, and won the series that way. Jerry Butler takes an incredibly illegal hit that Mike Bossy gets taken off on a stretcher. You know, Brian Trotche was playing with a broken nose the last couple of games. It was thuggery. And what we were loving it in Toronto because we saw thuggery come against us with the Flyers. But that was a big part. And Darryl Sittler even said, you know, as we started believing what Roger had said, Roger just said, okay, you know, we got to hit him every time. We got to do whatever, you know, whatever it is every time. It was vicious, you know, and there was still skill that was involved, but that was a big part in them upsetting the New York Islanders. You needed to do something unusual outside the box. And the thing was, well, that old adage, they can't put you in the box for everything the Flyers used to do, and the Leafs employed that. They just beat the crap out of the New York Islanders.
Well, with one little exception, which I learned about reading your book, and I did not know about this before, apparently Tiger Williams and Brian Trotche had a pre-existing friendship before this series, and as a result, Tiger sort of made it a point of honor that he wasn't going to go after Trotche. Tell us about that.
I didn't know this part till doing the book, and then since I've talked to Brian Trotche, he's talked about his book. I mean, like, they kid about it. They said, Tiger Williams said Brian Trotche's dad was the only guy he feared when he was a kid. That, you know, he, you know, just that, and then Trotche looked up to Tiger. He just said, you know, he was like a little puppy around Tiger Williams. And Tiger, you know, took him under his wing when they were playing in very rural Saskatchewan way back when. They actually were blood brothers. They did that kind of ceremony. That Tiger said that when they played the Islanders in general, he'd sneak off and meet Trotche a couple of blocks away from the hotel. They'd go out and Trotche would drop him off a couple blocks away, and they did that all the time. So, yes, in this playoff, they kind of would just wink at each other a bit. I think they did hit each other a bit, okay? But you're right as far as what Tiger did to everybody else. Yeah, he was. But also, Brian Trotche was a tough dude, okay? So there were guys that could stand up and take it from the Islanders. He was one of them. But, yeah, there was this incredible, and that's what you always like in anything, Steve, you know, the context of the stories beyond the stories. And that was one of them that I wasn't fully aware of.
Now, if anybody had said the Leafs have the ability to beat this Islander team, even though they were so overmatched, and not only would they win, but they do it without Börje Salming, we'd have said you're nuts. What happened to Börje in that series?
Well, Börje took an accidental stick from Lorne Henning, who was about the cleanest player in the NHL. And of course, then the Leafs were obsessed trying to get even with him afterwards and that. But he took a stick, and, you know, the documentary about him that's been on TV shows that it was a long summer for him. I mean, there was some question about his vision, his eye, and all that. So it was a serious, serious eye injury. Knocked him out. Fortunately, everything, you know, worked out in moving forward in his Hockey Hall of Fame career. And then Ian Turnbull, who was the number two defenseman there, who seemed to lack the motivation to be a superstar, whatever it was, played his best hockey of his life. But he says in the book, he goes, no, I always played that way. Nobody just noticed because they were watching Börje. Ian's kind of the Eddie Haskell of the Toronto Maple Leaf team back then. So anyway, they're without Börje. And then everyone acknowledges, even Chico Resch did. Like, Chico played fine. Mike Palmateer gave the Leafs the kind of goaltending that Freddie Anderson hasn't done in recent years when he was here, or anybody of late. Curtis Joseph, Ed Belfour did it. The kind of goaltending that not just maybe even steals you, or certainly steals you a game or two on your way to winning a playoff series.
Let's look at the violence again, because, okay, let's make the list here. Börje Salming is out for the reasons you just explained. Lanny McDonald's got a broken nose. Brian Trottier's got a broken jaw. Mike Bossy from the Butler hit has been taken off on a stretcher. This was a war of attrition. To the best of your knowledge, did anybody from head office in the NHL take the teams aside at any point and say, guys, please clean it up? This is awful.
No. You know, it's funny because a few years later, and this would probably be right around then, because Mike Nicolick became the head coach of Leafs in 1981. So back in 1978 or so, when he was assistant coach with the Broad Street Bully Philadelphia Flyers, he said, like, you know, once in a regular season game, it was late in the year, and they basically had a line brawl and with somebody. And Lloyd Gilmore, who was considered a respected official, just gave two minors, like one to each team. And he said to them later, he goes, actually, the league wasn't happy about that. So, I mean, that's what it kind of took back then. And it was, as Chico Resch said, it was a brutal time in his opinion, looking back, but it was the time, and things carried on that way for a number of years. I think one of the great points then was the Montreal Canadiens not only winning with skill, but the picture of Larry Robinson standing up and beating up Dave Schultz on a CBS Sunday afternoon game when the Flyers played the Montreal Canadiens, that part of it was the Montreal Canadiens had to stand up to the Flyers physically. So the point being, Stephen, is what the Leafs did. You had to figure it out on the ice. League ain't going to help you, okay? WHA was just as crazy. Some owners thought the violence sold tickets, okay? Thought the physicality sold tickets. And the WHA certainly did as well. So it was a part of the game back then.
Let me take you to Game 7 of that series. And surprisingly enough, even though the Leafs lost the first two, they won the next two. And then the home teams, again, each won three, and were Game 7 on Long Island. The Leafs had not won a series in overtime since Bill Barilko's goal in 1951. Was anybody giving them a chance in Game 7 on Long Island?
So you said have not won a series, correct? They'd won a game in overtime, not won a series, correct? Yeah. No. And they were, you know, you look back and watch the game, they're down to 4D. So I believe it's like Carlisle's back in now. Trevor Johansson's playing, Turnbull's playing, and I think Pellick was the fourth. Like, you're down to 4D. So they had other, you know, other injuries besides Börje Salming on the D side. Like, nowadays they talk about, you know, you play with six defensemen. If you're down to 5D, you go, oh my God, like whatever. So they were down in that regard. So that just added it. And also, this had been a series that the home team had won every game, right? So you kind of thought that was going to follow suit. But, you know, what we have learned more and more as you get older from then, Stephen, you know, just like you and I getting older, is that, boy, anything can happen in game sevens. But, you know, but back then, they certainly were the favorite team. So it like the 67 Stanley Cup, I remembered a little bit. I remember in 1978 being at my friend Ken Friedman's house, and when Lanny McDonald scored, like, I what age would I be then? I'd be like 21 or something like that. And just, oh my God, like it was the best. Or 20. I was 20. Like, oh my God, just like yelping, whatever you do. Like, man, this, you know, because the Jays were just started that year. There were no Raptors. We're big on the Argos. And it was the first best moment of my life as a Leaf fan.
I'm glad you put it into that kind of context, because people today will not appreciate how big a moment that was. Exactly right. In a year where the Blue Jays are they're only 2 years old. There are no Raptors. The Argos are of the Canadian Football League are still a bit of a big deal. But this was the first Leaf victory of significance in a very long time. And just as you were at your buddy's house watching the game, I'm going to put you on camera here for a second. I watched it at home with my family. And there's my 90-year-old father right there who's listening in on this interview. And I jumped into his arms after Lanny scored the goal, and my mother's arms as well. We had a big family hug. Can you describe, for those who didn't see it, describe Lanny's goal in overtime and the fact that it wasn't like so many goals we see today. It was not a greasy goal. He was full value for that goal.
So I'm going to describe the goal, but I didn't know your dad was there. And Stephen, you know, I told you years ago how my dad said to give you props. My late father, Ernie, just talked about how much he enjoyed you on TVO. I mean, like my dad's not a sports fan. So it's kind of weird, right? But anyway, he loved watching you. I believe I passed that on to you. I hope you remember that. And anyway, so that's just a very nice memory. So it was very nice meeting your father. They're really special in that. But my dad thought you're the greatest, whatever. So some people thought he had questionable taste, though. But anyway, no, my dad thought you're the greatest. So that's the great thing. So that goal surmises it. Exactly what you're talking about, Steve, about the Leafs win. Everything, it's helter-skelter. It's kind of a botched play. And it starts with Eddie Haskell, a.k.a. Ian Turnbull, saying, I'm not going to listen to Roger Neilson. Roger said we got to lay back in overtime. And I go, screw this. If we lay back, we're going to get killed. So the play starts, as Ian points out, that he actually goes aggressively for the puck more in the neutral zone, which kind of catches the Islanders by surprise. So it ends up being a puck that three different Islanders have a chance to get. Like, it's, there's no, like, it's so, it's not a play that you go, wow, look at that goal. And all of a sudden, holy crap, Lanny McDonald's got the ball, got the puck. And Lanny said the same thing. He goes, holy crap, I got the puck. I haven't been scoring. I can't even see with this football helmet I'm wearing on, you know? And he's kind of like, just trying to kind of think about whatever it is and gets a shot away. And it's not a razor. It's not like Steve Yzerman against St. Louis that year, whatever. And it goes in. It's almost like there's a delayed reaction. So when you're watching on TV, it's kind of like, and the Islanders come with the puck. And Turnbull chases it. And Lanny's got the puck. Score!
Now Turnbull clears it ahead to McDonald. McDonald, right, he scores!
McDonald wins it! The Leafs win it!
And the Leafs win it! 2-1 and a goal by Lanny McDonald.
Lanny McDonald has had such a tough time of it in this series, scoring goals. He started to come out of his slump the other night in Toronto, and now he comes through with one of the biggest goals of his career as Lanny McDonald and the Leafs win it.
You know, and that's it. It was as ugly as that series really was in a lot of ways.
I heard stories after the fact that the Islanders were so shocked when that was over, in part because they were so sure they were going to win, they had actually made financial commitments. Like, guys had promised their wives they would buy them this, that, or the other thing. Can you describe a bit the state of mind the Islanders were in after that series was over?
Well, you know, so one of the other things they wonder is that whatever their song was that they played when they won a game, they must have thought they're going to win it. So they played it. So the Leafs are celebrating, and they're just reveling in the Islander whatever songs. They started singing it loud, and it pissed the Islanders off. But why are you playing? I don't even know what the song was. It's kind of like the Gloria equivalent for the St. Louis Blues. So it started with that. But, yeah, it was, like they all say, you know, it was the worst series. It took a long time to get over that. It helped them grow in some ways. Like, they kind of looked at it that they had it. They said, okay, Chico said, we have to be ready for anything, including what he felt, a criminal team, basically a criminal act. The next year, when they lost to the Rangers, it was they felt the pressure got to them about playing the Rangers. Okay, that they learned to deal a different kind of pressure, kind of more off the ice. And then they won their 4 Stanley Cups in a row. But no, this was, if they never won a Stanley Cup, they would be looking back at this as Leaf fans look back to the 93 LA Kings series, you know, and all that, and not getting to the Stanley Cup final for starters. So this was a bitter, bitter, ugly pill for the Islanders to swallow.
Well, Mike Bossy, as you point out, wrote in his memoir, the hoodlums had won. That was the way he looked at it. I wonder whether, okay, so the Leafs are on the top of the hockey world right now. They're just feeling so great about everything. The fans are, they're just loving every second of it. And a week and a half later, the season is over. They get swept 4 straight by the Montreal Canadiens. And I wonder, you know, as you have the ability to look back at this 45 years later, 46 years later, did the Leafs just expend everything they had to beat the Islanders and there was nothing left for the Habs, or were the Habs just that much better and we're going to win anyway?
Definitely the latter. And I think every goal was a 1-goal win and 2 went to overtime. So mm-hmm. I know it was a 4-game sweep, but it's you should have an asterisk there. 4-game sweeps look terrible, and they're a terrible way to end a season. So what changed, Steve, was that they talk about that year. Harold was loving it. That year, he kind of stayed loving winning. It was kind of new, novel. So he was kind of out of the way. Then the next year, they weren't quite as good during the regular season. Roger was now not innovative, but he was boring, which was a common criticism about his style of hockey. And then, and that's when all of a sudden King Clancy started talking to Harold about Punch Imlach, the return of Punch Imlach, because he got fired in Buffalo. So the next year was all different again. And then when they got swept, all of a sudden it was more of a thud. So yeah, again, not making, and again, this year I look at two teams like the New Jersey Devils and Seattle Kraken. And I kind of say, you know, it's important when you grow and evolve that there's got to be a consistency to it. I mean, they both made the playoffs last year and won a playoff round, and neither will probably make the playoffs this year. And that's psychologically always kind of a setback that way. And that's what the Leafs had that following year. But to get back to answer your question, 2 years in a row, they lost to the team that won the Stanley Cup. And much like the Islanders did after losing to the Leafs, they didn't lose their mind and get rid of Clark Gillies or Brian Trotsche or Dennis Potvin or, you know, any of those particular players. Whereas Punch Imlach started doing that with the Leafs, whether, you know, Lanny McDonald and others, and all of a sudden, you know, like we know in life, everyone always goes, blow it up in any sport when they get pissed off at their team. That's the easy part. Putting it back together is the difficult part. And Punch Imlach showed that blowing it up, it wasn't difficult, but it was very hard to get it back.
Well, the next question is admittedly in the realm of speculation here, but if the Leafs, for whatever reason, had decided not to fire Roger Neilson and not to bring Punch Imlach back, but instead had let that team sort of fulfill whatever its destiny was meant to be, how far do you think they might have gone had they kept the band together?
Well, I mean, these guys were still in their prime. So, Steve, another 2 or 3 years anyway, and being a contender for the Cup. And that's what you have to be first, because then winning, it's an imperfect science. But, you know, why 3 years later could they not beat that New York Islander team again that, you know, they'd beaten 3 years earlier? So that's the what if we will never know. It certainly had to improve from that 78 team. We kind of opened our chat today about certainly needed a better center, certainly needed another D back there, you know, some of those types of things to go. But then again, once you get in the playoffs, if you get a hot goaltender, that's plan A. You know, they got him that year. Palmateer continued. So it's unfulfilled. You'll never know. But certainly for a Stanley Cup in kind of that 2-3 year period, very, very definitely not out of the question.
I want to do now a real fast forward with you here, and that is take you back to a moment just a year and a half ago. The last time we all saw Börje Salming alive was at a very emotional ceremony at Scotiabank Arena. We didn't know at the time. We probably suspected, but he was only a few days away from dying of ALS, Lou Gehrig's disease. And there he was at center ice with Darryl Sittler and Lanny McDonald. Darryl was, and Matt Sundin was there too, I guess. Darryl was completely in tears. And then something, though, just before that happened, and I want to read the excerpt from your book about that, because I didn't know any of this, and this was fascinating. You write, "I walked over," this is before the game, "put my hand out and said, 'Hey, Börje, Gord Stellick.' There was a momentary pause, then he grabbed my hand firmly, and then he hugged me. It became a 3-minute hug. He kept trying to talk. He was crying. It was one of the saddest and most beautiful moments of my life." You admit in the book you guys didn't know each other all that well. So how did that moment happen?
Well, we hadn't seen each other for a while. But, I mean, I'd been there, like, from 1975 to 89 with Börje. Like, we had a special kind of bond. But since then, I'd run into him from time to time. But to your point, Steve, yeah, I had not seen him a ton over the last number of decades or whatever. But, you know, I was the general manager when he left to go to Detroit. And it was a very small traveling group back then. And, you know, I just love Börje. I love Börje. So, I don't know where the word, but we had a neat kind of bond. So in that, and actually when I talk about it, it's a little bit different than that, in that it's why we wrote the book, Damien and I, about the impact and that night, all those fans just, you know, feeling it, whether modern fans or older fans. So on the Friday night was the Hockey Hall of Fame game, and that's when we first saw Börje on TV with Darryl and Mats and that, and we were aware about the gravity of his situation. So the next day was Saturday, so it was a rare back-to-back. They do that on a Hall of Fame weekend. They have two home games back-to-back that Börje himself was honored. So I was at that game. So it didn't happen before the game. So I was at that game, and I'm watching again on center ice, and Börje, Sheldon Keefe starts, it's the 6 Swedish players, and you just see the emotion again. We were a little more ready for it. given the circumstance of seeing him the night before. So I worked pregame and intermissions on radio on the Fan on the games. So a friend of mine, by coincidence, I don't do it very often, had said, hey, you know, afterwards, pop down, you know, by my box to say hi, maybe have a glass of wine, whatever. But anyway, so I got a quick way I can exit. So it's about the start of the second period, and I see some of the Leaf alumni, like Tom Ferguson and Ally Afraidy and that, kind of walking in the boxes area. But I know the alumni box is in a different location. And I said, what are you guys doing down there? They go, oh, that's the box Börje is in. It's just a few down from, Tom Bitto was the friend I was visiting. He's been a friend for a lot of years. So anyway, there was a big, like Larry Tannenbaum was outside the box. There was a lot of people around it, were a lot of people. So I went in and hung with my buddy Tom and a few others, about, you know, 7-8 minutes or so. And I left to go because I had to get back up for the second intermission. And there was the door there, and there was nobody at the door where Börje was. So, you know, Steve, it's one of those things I always impart upon our kids about, it's better to do something and maybe regret doing it than not doing it. So I thought, oh, you know what? So I opened the door and it was quiet there. And there's Boria's son, Anders, who is an adult. I remember him as a kid. And there was Börje with his wife. So just in the last, sitting by themselves in the third tier. So you describe it right. So I just went over and thought, I don't know this is going to go. And I just said, hey, Börje, Gord Stellick. And his first look, because a lot of it's because of his of the illness, I'm thinking this isn't going well. But then I realized, no. So he grabbed my hand. And, you know, Steve, he was still really strong. I know you could see on the ice the effects of it. But, man, this guy was a stud. Granite. Oh, man. And then, like I said, probably one of the longest hugs I've had with a male, knowing that that was going to be our last time. And yeah, it just was. And in some ways, initially, I didn't talk about it because it seems a little self-serving, like the weeks after Börje died, like who knows him better? That's not what it's about. It was just ended up being tragically for him, but just for me, like a wonderful, very, very human moment.
Lovely. You know, there is recency bias in sports. So I put that on the record here before I ask you this next question. Is Börje Salming the best defenseman in the history of the Toronto Maple Leafs? Because there was a guy there before him named Tim Horton who was pretty good as well. But what do you say?
I say yes. And that's not a slight against Tim Horton, not a slight at all against Tim Horton, because you're 100% right. It's so difficult to assess different eras. I mean, your dad there, he'd have very strong opinions about his eras. And that's why when you try to bring Bobby Orr, you know, are we giving Quinn Hughes enough pops compared to the aura of Bobby Orr? Tim Horton has a lot more Stanley Cup rings than Börje is ever going to have. So I don't know whether factors or not, but it just, he kind of did what Orr did about a different style. So this is no disrespect to Tim Horton. Just like Austin Matthews is going to supplant Dave Keon and whomever as the, best Leaf of all time at some particular point. You hope it includes Stanley Cups as well. But, I'm biased and you brought that up. But no question, the best defenseman of all time on the Toronto Maple Leafs.
The last line of your book reads as follows. It wasn't a championship, but given all the circumstances, it certainly mattered. What mattered at the end of the day, as you look back on it, about a team that really, I mean, they only reached the semifinals twice, and then they got blown up. And if you think about it, they didn't actually get all that close to winning a championship. So why is it all these years later, so many of us still care about that team so much?
Well, we wouldn't know that at the time about all these years later. But at the time, Steve, what I think is you and I grew up and we heard about, and you see the book over that shoulder, but about the 67 team. So, hey, we're kids in Toronto. Where the hell are the Stanley Cups? Our parents are talking about, again, 16 NHL versus 12, 14, 16 team NHL, whatever. Where are these Cups? Come on, what's going on? So we've heard of all these, and now we get that era where the WHA starts. You're not even close. You're one of the worst teams. So then you get to grow with your own Tim Hortons and Dave Keons and George Armstrongs and Frank Mahovlich's with these guys. And it's a little slow, and there's playoff disappointment, which is why I think it compares to the current 2024 Leafs so much that, you know, it takes a bit longer than you thought, and there's 7-game series losses to the Philadelphia Flyers and that kind of heartbreak. And then all of a sudden you get that, okay, they'd always got by the first round never the second round, and then you do. So all of a sudden for us, it was our watching the 60s team grow and win that cup in 67, and we got to watch it. Yeah, euphoria, not a Stanley Cup, but just a great moment, a seven-game series as well when you counted yourself out. So that part was why I think it was really special for a certain age group. I'm sure people that were older would say, well, no, I thought it was neat, but I can remember the actual cups. And then, you know, decades later, again, to talk about it, like a bunch of homegrown guys, and what kind of ovations would they get when they go to Scotiabank Arena? Still huge, huge ovations. You know, Lanny, Tiger, Darryl, Börje, you know, those guys, Palmateer, like huge, still populate, you know, still popular. And here you got Darryl Sittler's going to be, what's the date, March 27th. He's getting the Conn Smythe Achievement Award, you know, like human humanitarian award for service, whatever. Mm. Well, lifetime Achievement Award. The Conn Smythe dinner, benefits Easter Seals kids. So the guy that is going to introduce him and is excited about it is Lanny McDonald. With Lanny's recent health situation, Tiger Williams confirmed that he'll be coming. Now Lanny is looking forward to that. We saw him, he was out last week for the first time in public, and he's got that marked down that he wants to be there for Darryl. So that's going to be really neat on March 27th, those guys, and it's going to tear the house down. Like they're, you just say their one name and everybody knows who they are and everyone smiles.
We maybe you could help us with an update on that. Lanny, did he have a heart attack? Is that what happened? And how is he now?
Well, last weekend he was at a first appearance at a Flames game in a box. So he had a heart attack. I saw him All-Star weekend like a lot of people did. He was flying back, and we can only hope we have that kind of luck that we're not on a plane. We get off a plane and you have a heart attack in the tarmac. A nurse happens to be nearby, and you get that kind of help from, regular people that step in and good Samaritans. And then, you know, he talked about the EMS and all that. So he did have some bypass surgery, and, he dodged a bullet. And we'll see. It's a couple weeks away, and I don't know if he can travel or not, but he's intent on making it there. But again, that's what's special about that team, Steve. We're talking about all these years later, and we're totally up to speed about all those guys.
I'm going to give the name of the book one more time, and then I've got to do two more things with you, Gord. Revival, the chaotic, colorful journey of the 77-78 Toronto Maple Leafs. I really enjoyed the book. You hit me right in my sweet spot because that, of course, I was 18 in 1978. So this was a hugely influential team in my life. And we talked about Tim Horton and Börje Salming being the players of the 60s and 70s defensemen for their respective generations. I've always heard this guy talk about Gus Mortson back in the day.
Gus Mortson and Jim Thompson.
Gus Mortson and Jim Thompson were my dad on defense. There you go. I wanted to get you an answer on that just to complete that circle. And then, as is our tradition here on Hockey Time Machine, I want to ask Glenn Dreyfus to join us and just add a few reflections to what he's heard. Glenn, come on in here.
I think one of the great things this book does is it should forever put to rest the idea that you have to win a championship to be a beloved team. Just like with players, Matt Sundin never even made it to a Stanley Cup final. Should he not be beloved? You know, Marcel Dion never made it past the second round. You know, should we not honor him? So this was a great show. At all that's left for me to do is nitpick. So I will.
So you will.
Okay. Gord, Steve may only have one goal in 12 games, but he plays the 200-foot game, and he's really good in the room.
Thank you, Glenn. Appreciate you coming to bat for me there.
Okay. Now, one other. Don't call someone Eddie Haskell. Call him Robin to Salming's Batman or Dreisaitl to his McDavid, but not. That's a Ballard-level insult. I'm going to give you the chance to take that back.
Well, no, I'm not going to, because Ian Turnbull, it's great. You need the contrarian. So you got Ian Turnbull should be in line with all these guys. He should be at the Conn Smythe dinner. He has no interest. He talked about it. He said, I don't like hockey. I hated playing for the Leafs. I hated hockey. I love music. I just happened to be really good at it. I couldn't stand Roger. Everyone said he'd wreck Roger's drills all the time and that. But you know, he and Salming were 1-2. He goes, look at the year before. You look it up when Red Kelly's last year, they had stats that were off the chart. Roger wrecked it all. So he's just the guy that, you know, whatever, pulls no punches. And at the end of it, I said to him, because these guys, Darryl said, they're as close as they were 40 years ago, like Tiger, Börje, you know, Lanny, and him. And I said to Ian, I said, well, okay, who are you close with from your NHL days? Nobody. just a different way about it. But to your point, Glenn, I should pay more tribute because they don't have him, they don't beat the Islanders as well. That's probably the one big player besides Mike Palmateer, especially when Börje went out, that was a difference. And that's also a mystery. Like, Steve, how far could they have gone? Would Turnbull have played like that? Would he have been invested to play like that? That would have been a big thing. He didn't seem to be. Like, could we have done that 79, 80, 81? I don't think so. He really wasn't into it that much.
No, that's a fair point.
One serious question, if you'll let me. Because the team you write about, the Leafs team, was unusual, weren't they, Gord, in that they were homegrown. Even if you have to include Jerry McNamara going over to Sweden to bring back Salming and Hammarström.
No, absolutely. And so, by the way, the book is at Indigo, and you can order on Amazon just to get back to it. But I think, Glenn, about it is why I like it. It so relates to these guys that, okay, even though Salming and Hammarström were Swedish, they're homegrown Leafs, basically. It's their first team. And all those other guys were drafted by the Leafs, including, you know, Pat Buttet, a few others. I mean, and that's a comparable to the elite core that they have now that didn't exist in Pat Quinn's run and didn't exist in Pat Burns' run. You know, Doug Gilmore came from elsewhere and Matt Sundin came from elsewhere and that. So to me, that's kind of a neat part. And you're really seeing now the kind of the growth of the personalities of Matthews, Marner in different ways, Nylander, Morgan Rielly. Like, you're kind of seeing that. They like being in Toronto, like these guys did. You know, they're comfortable about being in Toronto. It's a tough market. It's a different market. It's not for everybody. And that's another reason, you know, Damian and I looked at it that, you know, and because they have not yet had playoff success commensurate with the kind of team they are, just like this team never did, except for that one series.
Well, Glenn, as you know, because you had me on the Hockey Time Machine not too long ago to talk about the last game of Maple Leaf Gardens, and I wore a particular T-shirt that night, which I got at the last game. You know, I was at the last game, etc. So I don't know if you can see this. I'm going to tilt the screen down a little bit. This is the shirt I'm wearing today. And, you know, that's the CN Tower in the middle, for those who don't know, the Toronto skyline. And then the rest of the buildings in the city are basically the names of Maple Leaf players. And even though this shirt was printed, I think just a few years ago, look at the size of Sittler and Salming. They're big. Like, this team does capture a great part of the city's imagination even 45 years later. It's really something. So Gordon, you and Damian have really done a great solid for those of us who love this team and who love to follow hockey, because they were something special. So thank you.
Well, tough to read on your washboard stomach as well, all the names going on there, but you don't see enough and Kessel, you know, and I'm not denigrating those players, but again, to your point, that's exactly about reaching in the past because it's relevant in the present.
Right on.
My pleasure, by the way.
Thanks so much. That's Gord Stellick. Glenn, you want to finish us off here?
Well, I just recommend for Gord's next book, I'd like an examination of why Tom Fitzgerald and Gord Roberts didn't get silver sticks when they played their 1,000th game on the same night. Fitzgerald, who's now the Devil's general manager, and yes, it bugs him.
You know, well, that's a funny one, because the Leafs have gone overboard nowadays doing all that stuff. Yeah. And I will say, whether you want to call Harold Eddie Haskell or not, you know, that he did give the silver tea services to Darryl Sittler and Ian Turnbull for particular. Like, it was a very odd gift to give 20 young 20-year-olds a silver tea service. He must have got a deal on them, that for Sittler for his 10-point night, Turnbull for his 5-goal night. And I remember they talked about it once. They still had it. And I think Turnbull put some cleaning stuff on and it really wrecked it or something. You're kind of talking. But anyway, there we go. So that makes up, I hope, for Gordy Roberts and Tom Fitzgerald.
Amen. That's great. Thanks, everybody. Good night.